Recorded Books presents At Paradise Gate by Jane Smiley, narrated by Suzanne Toren. The author opens this novel with the following short extract from Triste Tropique by Claude Lévi-Strauss. While I complain of being able to glimpse no more than the shadow of the past, I may be insensitive to reality as it is taking shape at this very moment, since I have not reached the stage of development at which I would be capable of perceiving it. A few hundred years hence, in this same place, another traveler, as despairing as myself, will mourn the disappearance of what I might have seen, but failed to see. I am subject to a double infirmity. All that I perceive offends me, and I constantly reproach myself for not seeing as I should. And now, At Paradise Gate.
Part 1. Like their father, Anna Robison's three daughters loved to remember. They were around most of each day now that Ike was sick, and sometimes Anna thought of them as sort of a committee, hammering out an agreed-upon version of their common history. Except that they rarely agreed. Their stories varied widely in the most basic details, and none of the three could be convinced of anything. As Anna put down the butter dish and surveyed the table, ivory plates, mats she'd crocheted herself, ice-filled water glasses, the discussion jangled around her. "It wasn't that way at all," caroled Helen, the eldest, the blondest, the one who had inherited Ike's stature and commanding manner, bringing salad from the kitchen. "I met him at a USO dance, and 2 weeks later he introduced Claire and Geo. I remember it distinctly." Cutting across contradiction, she continued, "Are we ready, Mother? It's a shame that Christine, Helen's daughter, was due to arrive from Chicago at any minute. Claire, the second child, and Helen's lifelong challenger, seemed, by contrast, normally brown-haired, conventionally hazel-eyed. She pulled out her chair with an air of immovable conviction. "He married Vida Deacon. Don't you remember her, Claire?" Helen sat down in her own place on the other side of the table. "I knew Geo for 3 weeks before that USO dance, Helen. I met him through Dennis somebody, that fellow whose plane got shot down the last day of the war." "Claire, you're wrong!" Helen lifted her hands and pitched her voice high in the "I won't say another word" range. That Geo had been Claire's husband for 25 years, which somehow certified her version of the meeting, was not alluded to. To Susanna, the youngest, Anna passed scalloped potatoes. Susanna, who was a little overweight, received them reverently, then said, "Remember Daddy used to say that that guy had the biggest feet and the smallest chin in 6 counties? "Bobby had a perfectly normal chin," said Helen. "You're thinking of Bob Lowe, who had those freckles, too, even on his eyelids." These Anna could recall, in the folds of his ears as well. Bob Lowe was the most freckled person Anna ever knew. Ike had turned so many of the incidents in Anna's life into tales that usually she tried to avoid recollection. But fragments, like the fall of light or the shape of someone's cheek, often occurred to her, as Bob Lowe, freckled into the very caves of his ears, did now. "Is that Daddy?" said Claire. The women at the table hushed, their forks suspended in air and their eyebrows lifted, but no call came again. "Mother, you really—" Anna stared doggedly at her plate. Claire and Susanna were at her about this 10 times a day. Wouldn't she please move Ike into the living room or the dining room? But Anna would not, and dared not mention the idea to Ike. Such an illness that meant displacement of furniture and attention to the minutiae of her daily routine, was sure to be a final illness. Silence fell around the table again, not a listening silence, but a worried one. Do you know that story about Uncle Abel and the bull, Mother? Christine spoke of it over the phone the other night, and I didn't recall it all exactly. Of all her daughters, Anna thought Helen had the only interesting voice, musical but with a hollow quality that made it both strong and fragile. Although her clear, effortless tones were always cheering and alluring, they were never convincing. She sat in an upright, perching posture, and her eyes or hands often strayed after the cigarettes she had given up 5 years before. Anna wondered if she realized this habit. "I do," said Susanna. "Daddy told me himself. You were living on the ranch, weren't you, Mother?" Anna nodded. And the lupins were in bloom. They spread in a great azure triangle behind the house, stiff, cone-shaped, vibrating against the green of the back paddock. Susanna went on. "Uncle Abel was castrating a bull that he'd tied to the fence post." "I can't believe he just tied the animal to a fence post, Susanna," said Claire. "A quick snip," Abel always said. He was a huge and terribly impatient man who wouldn't have the vet or even the neighbors on the ranch to help. Anna nodded. "It's true," declared Susanna. "That's how it started to get loose. It was tossing its head, and the loop in the rope fell out, and Uncle Abel looked up and saw the bull with its head turned, peering at him." Anna had sometimes wondered if Abel had been afraid or merely angry. He had such a large head and gruff manner that she could never imagine him afraid, only transported into a higher degree of fury. "Then it started to bellow." "Yes," said Anna, desperate bellowing that the big horns to the west threw back at them. "Daddy was coming out the door. He saw what was happening, grabbed the axe from the chopping block, and flung it across the backyard, and struck the bull exactly between the ears. Dropped it in its tracks." "Hatchet," said Anna. "It was the hatchet." "Daddy said axe. Anyway, then he said, 1st and 10. "He did say something funny. I can't remember what it was." Anna had followed him out of the house, Helen in her arms. June colors in the mountains, especially vivid in the silence that followed the death of the bull. The animal lay in a black heap on the ground, his hide still glistening with health, and Abel stood behind, the shears dangling from one hand, his mouth agape, red blood across the indigo front of his new overalls. And blood covered the head of the bull like a bandana trailing in the dust. Helen had said her newest word. "Bye? Bye-bye?" "What's that?" This time they all heard it.
"Mother! Mother!"
in a thin, demanding voice. "I'll go," said Claire. She scraped her chair back and threw her napkin on the table. Ike would not be glad to see her, Anna knew. He preferred to keep his illness private between husband and wife. Her calves hurt so, though, and her heels, too, that she welcomed a few moments of preparation. If Ike really wanted something, he would want it from her alone. Anna and the others ate without speaking until Claire returned.
"Sure enough."
"He wouldn't tell me," she reported. "He just said, 'Where's Mother?'"
"He generally does."
Anna could not suppress a small scowl. In spite of Helen, Claire, and Susanna, she felt tired to death by dinner every evening. The staircase creaked under her weight, and she pulled herself up the last two or three steps with the banister. He was already calling out,
"Mother! Mother!"
"Yes, Ike?"
It was only since the onset of these latest problems that she'd begun to feel comfortable with his given name again. For most of their married lives, they'd addressed each other as the children did. Sometimes, recently, he too called her Anna. Maybe it was a bad sign. He'd put on a shirt, and was now propped against the wall at the head of the bed, fingering Winesburg, Ohio. He loved Winesburg, Ohio. He looked at her without speaking, waiting for her to ask him if he needed to go to the bathroom. She did not want to ask, but did anyway. He nodded. It annoyed her that after all these years he couldn't bring himself to speak of going to the bathroom. In the hospital, the nurses had had a terrible time with him and finally had to give in. He would use a bedpan only when Anna was there to help him. She didn't see how he could tolerate the discomfort, but it was something she could not ask about. He threw off the covers and pivoted his feet to the floor and his slippers.
Is Christine here yet?
Not yet.
It's getting late, don't you think?
She'll be all right.
Is he coming with her?
Ike was ashamed that he couldn't even remember Todd's name, though Christine had been married for a year and a half. Anna shook her head. She'd answered this question repeatedly for the last 3 days.
He's got to work, Ike.
This was a good sign. If the boy were to skip work, it would mean that something urgent was bringing him to his grandfather-in-law. But nothing was. The boy was safely at his job. Anna held out her arms, and Ike took them. As always, she left him standing in the middle of the bathroom, then went out and closed the door. She had, of course, never told him that she could hear his labored steps over to the bowl, and then his grunts and exhalations as he lowered himself upon it. Fortunately, the sink and the bathtub were within reach, so that once finished, he could stand, wash and dry his hands, then call for her. On his bad days, she waited, anxious for the loud thump of a fall, but it never came. Outside the door, she was breathless herself. Though Ike had grown terribly thin, he topped her by 7 inches, and it was not easy to support him, even as far as the bathroom. Claire met her at the bottom of the stairs. "Does he want any dinner, Mother? I'll be glad to make up a tray." Anna shook her head.
"He's going to read his book for a while. We can take something up to him later."
"Maybe he'd like to come downstairs."
"He said not."
They had finished. Helen was fumbling in her purse. Susanna pressed her finger onto the last crumb on her plate and pushed it to her tongue. Hardened potatoes, scattered succotash, and the partially eaten pork chop at her place repelled Anna so completely that when Claire, seeing her distaste, offered to warm them, she could not regain her appetite. "I'll make coffee then," said Helen, swallowing the last of her water. "I wonder where Christine is, I really do. She was supposed to leave by 8 this morning, which would have gotten her here hours ago." "Helen, don't you realize that kids never know when they're going to do anything? You've got to ask them their plans, then give them 3 days either way, in case something comes up." Claire's twin sons had been home for Christmas. Susanna followed Helen into the kitchen with a stack of plates. When Claire shifted into her sister's place beside Anna, Anna knew that a scenario had been planned in her absence. "Mother, listen." Claire leaned forward energetically, causing Anna to wince involuntarily for the water glasses, but Claire pushed them out of her way. "Susanna and I have mentioned it, and Helen agrees. You've got to bring Daddy downstairs. What if he were to call you and you didn't hear him? His voice isn't that strong anymore."
"I generally hear him fine, Claire."
"Mother, be sensible. Anything could happen. He could fall and be unable to call out, for instance. Please let us move the dining room table out back just for a little while and put him in here."
"But then maybe I wouldn't hear him at night, Claire."
"This is the best way. It's more important that I be nearby in the night." Claire took a deep breath. Obviously, they had foreseen this argument and discussed it. "You could move into the living room." Her glance at Anna as she said this was nothing so much as furtive. Anna sat back in her chair.
The house was very neat now that Ike spent most of his time upstairs. Since his illness, she had shampooed the rug and made a slipcover for his old chair. The magazines were stacked and put away. The tabletops were clear of everything except their allotted knick-knacks. If she moved Ike down here, and worse, if she moved down here herself, furniture would be pushed to the wall and new furniture introduced. Nothing would have a place of its own. She'd always be stepping on things or rummaging for them among a million other things. There would be nowhere to sit down, nowhere to get away. The place would never be clean again. And worst of all, everything about their recent problems would be as open and vulnerable as Ike's white sheets. He would hate that. In a flash, she realized that she would, too, although she had always championed candor in the face of his secretiveness. She looked at Claire, who was now peering at her. It was hard to deny logical and self-confident Claire, whose hardships and griefs never seemed to have thrown any doubt upon the efficacy of logic and confidence. Anna cast around for excuses. At last she said, "Claire, I could never get him upstairs to the bathroom." Claire continued to look at her searchingly. "And you know, or you should know, that your father would never use a bedpan, especially in the dining room." Anna could not help feeling a little triumphant at dredging up this insuperable difficulty. But Claire smiled. Yes, Ike was peculiar. She sat up and arranged some pieces of silver on the placemat before her. At last, she brought it out. "Then, Mother, you've got to get Daddy a nurse. He deserves it, and you do too." Anna opened her mouth. "Mother, if Medicare won't pay for it, we three will." Susanna was standing in the doorway to the kitchen, and Helen, craning her neck, came up behind her. Anna glanced at Claire and saw her give the briefest notion of a shrug. The other two sprang to the table as if choreographed. "Mother, it really is best," exclaimed Susanna. "You've got a third bedroom right across from Daddy's room. It would be just like having somebody for a boarder, except that she'd be helping you instead of you taking care of her. You're 72 years old now, and you just can't be running up and down the stairs all day."
"Don't use my age against me."
"She's not using it against you," said Claire. "Nothing is against you. This is for you." Anna looked at Helen and saw that Helen was looking around the room. After a moment, her eyes met Anna's and her eyebrows lifted. She said, "Mother doesn't want to be invaded, Claire. I understand that." She would go no further, though, and Anna felt as if she were being accused of mere house pride. Her arthritic shoulder began to throb. Telling her to embrace the nurse idea? To show her interfering daughters to the door? She had lived all her married life with relatives. Ike's brother, her children and grandchildren, for 10 years her own sister. But all of them had pursued their own lives, and she had never felt observed by them. Now these daughters wanted to introduce a stranger whose whole life would be to observe. She didn't want her marriage to end as a topic of someone else's conversation. End? Well, it wasn't about to end anyway, but that wasn't the point. Helen sighed with audible resignation. "I go along with them, Mother. Daddy deserves it. It should be easier for him than it is." "Nothing will ever be easy for your father." Helen waved her hand, dismissing the remark. Susanna, always practical, offered to find the nurse herself. "You won't have to budge, Mother, really. You can have any kind you like. Small and silent, large and jolly, young, old, any kind."
"How about none at all?"
Each of them, in a gesture supremely characteristic of Ike, pursed her lips. They were thinking how stubborn she was, and Ike, she knew, had taught them to think this way. Her eyes filled with tears. Mother, please, pressed Claire.
Let's talk about it tomorrow, suggested Helen. The others nodded, and Anna did too. We can ask Daddy what he thinks.
This they wouldn't do.
Ike had only likes and dislikes. Anna, though, with her self-doubts and her wish to do the elusive right thing, was the chink in the family armor.
Will you promise you'll talk about it tomorrow, Mother?
Really? Anna sighed and nodded again. Helen got up and went to the front window.
Maybe that's Christine now, she said.
The Airedale came in first, wiggling and sniffing and trailing his leash. Christine was full of apologies for bringing the dog.
Todd has to work late twice this week, and I just hate to leave him by himself that much. Sit! Now stay!
For being so late.
I dropped Todd at the office, and then I was going to leave, but I had to go back home and pick up something, and then this evening I got so hungry I just had to stop.
For dropping her coat on the floor.
I'm sorry, Grandmother, let me pick that up. How's Grandfather?
Nelson, you must sit this instant! As she kissed each relative, Nelson wagged his tail and pressed himself between their legs, until finally she cried,
Nelson! You're driving me crazy, damn it! Go lie down!
She flopped into Ike's large armchair and apologized again, this time for cursing in front of them. She was so brisk and rosy from the damp outdoors that Anna wanted to inhale her. Claire, unimpressed and disapproving of the dog, declared,
He's certainly not well.
But Anna made a point of smiling at her granddaughter. She, too, had always found the dog rather frisky, but now she decided that with his alert, curly head and stiff little tail, he introduced a note of levity she appreciated. She turned on another light. Helen brought out the pot of coffee. The house warmed and quickened. Christine's coat lay over the back of a chair. Her hat and scarf hung on the doorknob. Nelson's coiled leash occupied the center of the coffee table. She acted completely welcome. And why not? She was. Anna said,
You'll be surprised at how your grandfather looks, Chrissy, but his condition's pretty stable. It's not good, but it's stable.
Christine nodded, her face sober. From upstairs came,
Mother! Mother!
Christine jumped up.
Let me go, Grandma!
Nelson followed her to the foot of the stairs. She was elaborately firm with him.
No, Nelson! Stay! You sit! Good dog! Now stay!
Nelson cocked his head as she ran up the stairs. On the landing, she kicked the phone off the hook, replaced it, called, Grandpa! At the sound of her voice, Nelson tore up the stairs, slipping, scrabbling for purchase, knocking against the banister. From upstairs came,
Oh, Nelson! Well, all right. Heel! Now sit! Good dog!
Then the murmur of voices. Mother, began Claire,
The dog won't hurt anything, interjected Helen. Daddy probably appreciates a little life around the place, the way we go around on tiptoe all the time.
Daddy's not as strong as you think, Helen, continued Claire. I think we all tend to overestimate what he can do, frankly. In fact, I'll tell you what I think. I think he needs a hospital bed, with a crank, preferably downstairs, and some kind of full-time attendance, as well as a respiratory machine just in case. I think the attendant should be fully trained, including in cardiopulmonary resuscitation. I think that to do less is to take a risk.
She lifted her chin and finished rather ringingly.
Helen set her own chin and fixed Claire with her steadiest gaze.
Even if he were on his last legs, Claire, Daddy would never need that kind of breathless, alarming treatment. I am at least as worried as you are, and I don't think that I overestimate his strength. In fact, I think it takes more strength to deal with that kind of readjustment than to put up with minor inconveniences that are familiar.
I think, began Susanna, but Claire interrupted. Helen, you'd have to agree that I've had more experience in this area than you have, and I know what I'm talking about. When Gia was ill,
We didn't care for the changes any more than Mother and Daddy would. But what you gain in terms of efficiency and safety far outweighs the initial difficulties. I wish you would listen to me, Mother.
Anna opened her mouth to say she knew not what, but Helen sat forward, cutting off her view.
Claire, she said, your experience is precisely what is standing in your way. You think that because something was right for Geo, then it is right, period. You know, you've always been this way. Once you make up your mind about something, then that's the right thing, forever and ever. Well, Daddy isn't Geo, and there isn't much similar about the two situations. I wish you'd listen to me, actually. I went along with you about the nurse, but this other stuff has gotten to be an obsession with you. A respirator! My God!
Open your eyes, Helen. Anna stood up.
Don't bicker, she said.
A creak on the landing silenced them and drew their gaze. Ike had pulled on trousers and smoothed down his hair and was now beginning to descend the stairs on Christine's arm.
Grandpa wanted to come down and watch the fight, said Christine.
You bet, said Ike. Claire's pretty tough, but Helen's got a good 20-pound, 4-inch advantage anyway.
He cocked his head and laughed, weakly but merrily, at his own joke.
Don't let me stop you. Don't let me stop you.
Their descent was painfully slow. On the landing sat Nelson, ears pricked forward, manners somehow attained. Claire stood up.
Sit here, Daddy.
Ike made his way to the chair and sat heavily, with evident relief. Christine said,
Grandpa, did you really used to pit Mom and Aunt Claire against one another?
You bet, said Ike. Best fight on the block. Your Aunt Claire's got quite a temper, you know. I'd sneak up to her and whisper in her ear that Helen was going to jump her if she went into the kitchen.
Meanwhile, he would have told me that Claire was looking for me, and I'd better get the jump on her when she got to the kitchen.
Then he'd turn out the light at the last minute, added Claire. Just terrific, let me tell you.
Who usually won, Grandpa?
Depended on who had the strategic advantage.
And you know who that depended on, Christine, said Claire. Your grandfather. Ike laughed again.
What about Aunt Susanna? No, lie down, Nelson.
Now, Susanna was different. Best not to get on the wrong side of Susanna. We handled her career with kid gloves.
Kid gloves? That's the first I've heard of any kid gloves, Daddy. It felt more like an iron fist.
What else? Cried Christine. Well, said Claire, after we were in school, there was the breakfast bonanza. Ike chuckled. You've never seen a live wire first thing in the morning till you've seen your grandfather. You'd get up and stagger down the stairs trying to see through your eyelashes without letting the sun in. And there he'd be, crouched at the table, supposedly eating his French toast, but really just waiting for you.
What's the capital of Maine? What's the Spanish word for bacon?
Then, while you were trying to wind up your brain, he'd kind of bounce a little in his seat.
Yes, Daddy, you did. As if you had so much energy that you just couldn't contain it. And pretty soon he'd say, Your sister got it in 15 seconds.
Can't blame a fellow for wanting to stir things up a little, laughed Ike, pleased with the memory of himself at 40, crouched.
Christine lay back against the arm of the couch.
Was it fun? It sounds like cheaper by the dozen. It must have been wonderful with so much going on.
A dozen would have been just about enough for Daddy, remarked Anna.
Everybody sighed. In a few moments, Anna laid aside her knitting.
Would you like some dinner, Ike? She offered,
but he waved the suggestion away. Lately, he'd been very coquettish about food, pretending that he wasn't hungry and wouldn't want to put her to any trouble. She rather thought he liked the martyrdom and so didn't press him.
Ike looked around and Claire rose to the bait. Anna pursed her lips, picked up her knitting, and began to count stitches with elaborate care.
You must be hungry, Daddy. Please let me fix you something.
Anna cleared her throat.
It's no trouble, persisted Claire. We had pork chops for dinner.
Ike deflated a little.
Pork doesn't agree with me lately.
Claire was on her feet. How about a little fruit salad and some slices of chicken from last night? I could warm them up. Or some yogurt.
No yogurt.
Claire headed for the kitchen. Anna knew Ike was looking at her, but she stared steadfastly at her knitting, moving her lips as if counting, although she'd counted them twice already.
What? Would he believe in her concern if she forced him to eat?
Finally, he said,
Well, Christine!
He leaned toward her and began to whisper. Christine laughed and demurred. Ike whispered some more. Out of the corner of her eye, Anna could see him jerking his head in her direction and winking at Christine, who laughed again and then nodded. She came up behind Anna's shoulder.
Grandma? Grandfather would like me to give you something.
In the time-honored tradition, Anna said, And what might that be? Christine laughed and put her fingers gently over Anna's shoulder.
The old eagle's claw!
She squeezed lightly. Anna squealed in the expected manner, and Ike slapped his knee. He had been sending Christine to her in this fashion since the girl was 3 years old. 20 years now, almost exactly. And he always did it for the same reason, because she wasn't paying attention to him, and he couldn't stand it. Anna dropped her knitting in her lap.
Some dessert? Helen? Susanna? There's ice cream in there, and I made a new kind of coffee cake yesterday. It's got Cheerios in the topping.
Cheerios? Howled Christine. Grandma, I'm ashamed of you.
I cooked on a wood stove too long to be ashamed of convenience foods, believe me, young lady. Anything in a box with a long shelf life is fine with your grandmother.
No ice cream for me, said Susanna. What kind is it?
Cherry something. Cherry delight?
Mmm. Come on, Aunt Susie, live it up.
When it comes to food, Chrissy, I live it up every day.
But she heaved herself out of the deep sofa.
I'll get it. Let's both get it. Mom, you?
Helen shook her head. Christine threw her arm over Susanna's shoulders and guided her out of the room. Nelson clicked at their heels. Ike turned immediately to Helen, who was leafing through a magazine.
What's the boy's name again, Helen?
Do you mean Todd, Daddy?
That's it. I couldn't remember that damned name if my life depended on it. I always think Frank. Why is that, Mother?
Wasn't there a boy named Frank, Helen?
I don't think so, Mother. Susanna had a boyfriend named Frank, though. Remember him? He bought that airplane after the war, some old piece of junk. You never would let Susanna go up in it.
She did, though. They flew to Chicago once and visited me at my studio. I don't think it was the only time, either. Susanna was very blasé about the whole thing.
What did she say, Mother? Susanna went up in a plane?
After the war, Ike, Susanna took some plane rides with a boy.
Ike wasn't always hard of hearing, or perhaps they were accustomed to speaking up. At any rate, the things he seemed to have difficulty with were always the things he shouldn't have heard in the first place, so that the embarrassment of shouting them out was doubled. Anna remembered that Frank quite well. Ike hadn't liked him because he was short, almost shorter than Susanna, who was the shortest of the girls. And Ike's distrust of the man's shortness hadn't masked any deeper feelings. In her life with Ike, she had found that his prejudice in favor of tall, burly men like himself was as simple as it was pronounced. Anna, on the other hand, had liked Frank, who was self-educated, without pretension, and plain-spoken, a more spirited and substantial man than Hanson Gilbert, Susanna's ex-husband, a doctor.
It was too bad about Frank. I had taken every opportunity to poke fun at him until Susanna finally gave up. Anna smiled to think of Susanna blasé about flying. Iowa must have been so beautifully green and simple just after the war. A tablecloth of old-fashioned crops like oats and rye, in addition to the eternal corn. Barns and houses, white and blocky. Clusters like jewels of black-and-white cows, glossy draft horses, and even mules. People must have waved to Frank and Susanna as they flew over. And Frank and Susanna, perhaps watching their shadow skate over meadow and wooded hillside, must have waved back. Anna caught her breath sharply and quickened her knitting. Such thoughts filled her with yearning to have been asked along.
"What boy? Mother? What boy?"
Helen interceded.
"Frank somebody, Daddy. He was from Council Bluffs or Omaha. You didn't like him."
"Little shrimp of a guy?"
Helen nodded.
"No," said Ike. "Couldn't see much in that punk. Not much at all."
Anna knew that Ike was teasing a little, but she couldn't help flaring up.
"No, Ike, you didn't see much in him, and you were wrong. He was a good boy, and he had lots of get-up-and-go. I knew that boy was going to be a big success, and he was crazy about Susanna."
Not many had been. Every time you took a step in those days, you stumbled over some kid who was dangling after Helen or Claire, or both. But Susanna hated to wear dresses, and she hated to fix herself up, and she was relentlessly competitive. She could apply any racket or stick or mallet or club to any ball, and the ball would fly like an angel. It never even occurred to her not to win, and a lot of first dates ended on the front porch with Susanna shaking the boy's hand, saying, "Thanks, and sorry I beat you."
"So what did he do, Mother?"
Ike leaned toward her. She should have foreseen this.
"I don't know, Ike. Flew off into the sunset, I guess."
Ike sat back triumphantly, and Anna leaned forward.
"But what does that matter? Hanson Gilbert was a big success, and you could hardly open your mouth, you were so impressed with the notion of a doctor. And look what happened."
Hanson was now married to the woman he had taken up with while still married to Susanna. Anna understood that they had something like 4 or 5 children, perhaps more. Susanna had none. Her marriage had ended so early, during Susanna's 27th year, that Anna had felt certain she would marry again and have 5 of her own. She loved children, especially little girls. But nothing happened.
"Frank's one we lost track of completely, isn't he?" remarked Helen, and picked up her magazine again. It was a family circle.
At home, Helen received Gourmet and The New Yorker and Archaeology. Here she always picked up The Family Circles and The Woman's Days and read while others talked. Anna said, "There's a cute sweater pattern in there, Helen. Man's pullover with a real smart cable. I thought I'd make a couple for the twins."
"You'd better ask Claire, Mother. I don't know if the twins wear the same clothes anymore."
"Ask me what?" Claire bore a small flowered tray on which she had arranged a dish of fruit salad and a plate of chicken slices bedded on a lettuce leaf, 2 neatly bisected pieces of toast, a linen napkin and a napkin ring, a glass of bluish skim milk, and a knife and fork. "The good silver," Anna noticed. She exchanged a glance with Helen, who also noticed, then said,
"There's a lovely sweater pattern in that magazine Helen's reading. I thought Jimmy and Jeremy each might like one."
"Don't ask me, Mother," she set the tray on Ike's lap. "Buying clothes for them is like sticking your money in a slot machine, as far as I'm concerned. Picky, picky, picky. Jimmy's the worst. He could lead me by the hand to the very item he wants, and then decide that the stitching around the buttonholes looks funny before we get to the checkout counter."
Ike began to eat.
The plate was too far from his mouth, and Anna could not help falling silent and staring as the fork wobbled and shook in its ascent. The others, too, were mesmerized, and before Claire could leap to amend the problem, Ike put down his fork and declared that he wasn't hungry. Claire offered to put a pillow on his lap, but it was too late. The peculiar sound the fruit made as it dropped onto the tray had done its damage. By the time they were finished discussing it, the peaches and pears would be warm, the chicken dry and unappetizing. Claire's face fell. Helen peered studiously at the magazine. Ike picked up his plate to put it on the table, and Anna sat up.
"Eat it, Ike," she commanded. "Claire put herself out for you, and it's the least you can do."
Ike looked at her. Claire put a sofa pillow on his lap and balanced the tray on it. In a moment, he began to eat. Anna realized she was breathing rather quickly. In years gone by, such a tone would have earned a retaliation, and it was hard for her to get used to her new power. In a few moments, he had finished the fruit and was safely to the chicken. She pushed her glasses up her nose and went back to her knitting. Ike said,
"Thank you, Claire. That was delicious."
"You're welcome, Daddy." Claire took the tray. Helen threw down her magazine.
"Christine and Susanna are taking their time," she observed.
Helen gave off a sense of laborious nonchalance when Christine was around that was almost an odor. With Anna, Claire, Susanna, even Ike, Helen was the most independent, the least likely to find family gatherings alluring, although she preferred to be present in case her name came up in discussion. Her feelings for Christine, however, were hot and possessive. It was at times amusing and at times discomforting to watch her arrange herself into the cool, detached being Christine both assumed she was and insisted she be. When she stood up, Claire turned deftly in the doorway and blocked her exit.
"Helen," she said, "why don't you show me the pattern Mother was talking about?"
"It's right there. You'll see it."
"Is there anything else in there you like?"
She put down the tray and half pushed Helen back toward the couch. Helen sidestepped, saying,
"You know homemade isn't my style."
The phone rang. Even as Claire was saying, "I'll..." and Anna was hoisting herself out of her chair, Christine flashed past the kitchen doorway and caught it on the third ring. Helen plopped on the arm of the couch, took up the magazine, and turned to the requisite page.
"There," she said. "Now get out of the way."
But Claire didn't move. Everyone strained to hear who it might be. Christine's voice murmured steadily, deepened by the tunnel effect of the back hall.
"It must be for her," said Claire. "I thought Jeremy might call over here tonight if he couldn't reach me at home."
Christine hung up the phone. There had been no pause in the murmuring, and Christine's face was red as she passed the back hall doorway on her return to the kitchen. Helen followed her, and Claire sat down on the couch with the dirty dishes in her lap.
"Mother," she said, "I think Christine has some news for us."
"Speak up," said Ike. "What about Christine?"
"She's got something to tell us," exclaimed Anna.
Ike nodded. Already he was tired. His skin was pale, and he let his head rest stiffly against the back of his chair, ashamed, perhaps, that a half hour with his family could tell upon him so, or perhaps afraid that she would make him go back to bed if he let on. He lifted his leg to cross it, and Anna vowed to get him a half dozen pairs of new, thick, very thick socks. His ankles thrust out of his trousers like bamboo.
Perhaps it was a baby.
Anna remembered each of her babies perfectly, more perfectly at times than she remembered her daughter's current selves. Having babies seemed to her the essential activity of youth, and she always felt sorry for mothers who were too old to be energetic and playful with their infants. She'd been only 20 when Helen was born, 21 with Claire. She'd attributed the difficulty of her third pregnancy to age. Now it made her laugh,
She'd been 25. Claire was the easiest baby. Any object would fascinate her, and she could occupy herself by the hour with a strip of fabric, changing it from hand to hand, flicking it with her index finger, folding it, pulling it, bunching it, laying it over her head or chest. Anna would come in from another room and see her seated on the floor. From the back, the great curve of her head with its brown-gold curls would taper into the hollow between the tendons of her neck, and somehow the tendons themselves would bespeak concentration. Although Anna loved Claire's and each child's smiles and waves and kisses, loved, too, the stroke of a little hand on her breast while the child nursed, chancing upon this quiet business with a piece of cloth had touched her the most. It was so mysteriously inward, when you hardly yet believed that the child had an inner life. These moments were invariably brief. Helen, who would be with Anna, who was always with her at that age, would run over to see what the baby had and if it was worth demanding for her own. Even if it were not, the fight would begin. And Claire, with her sturdy grip and vigilant concentration, was no mean opponent. Fights, yes, all the time. But better still, Anna could perfectly remember the intent angle of the head and the apparent fragility of the pale infant neck. Susanna came in from the kitchen, followed by Christine, who struck a posture in the doorway, tapped her chest with her fist, and burped discreetly.
"Oh, Grandmother, delicious! I outdid myself. I even outdid Susanna, didn't I? She had 3 scoops. I had 4.
Susanna groaned. Ike said,
"Remember when Abel and I used to sit down with a 5-pound box of chocolates and finish them before bed?"
"Grandpa, did you really?"
"Sure. Whitman's sampler we'd always get. Abel liked the creams and I liked the nougats. Of course, if your grandmother got there first, there'd be holes in all the bottoms where she'd stuck her thumb to see what they were. Had to have all the caramel centers or we'd never hear the end to it. She's got a sweet tooth."
Ike dislodged his false teeth and pushed them out of his mouth in a picket fence grin, then drew them back in. Christine and Susanna laughed. Helen and Claire smiled. Anna said,
"Now, Daddy, you never ate 5 pounds in a night, that's for sure."
Nelson, who had fallen asleep in the kitchen, came to the dining room doorway and yawned vigorously.
"Nelson!" exclaimed Christine. "Are you a good dog?"
Nelson wagged his tail and barked once. She squatted down beside him, saying,
"Pleased to meet you."
Nelson gave her his paw.
"What brings you to our fair city?"
Nelson barked twice. She went on in an elaborately solicitous tone.
"Aw, poor Nelson had a hard day, didn't he?"
Nelson's paws crept forward until he was down. Then he flopped over onto his side and closed his eyes. Christine cooed,
"Night, night, Nelson. Sleep tight."
Ike laughed. In a moment, Christine jumped up.
"Morning, Nelson! Breakfast time!"
Nelson jumped to his feet, then carefully sat back on his haunches and began to lift his front legs. He lost his balance immediately.
"Good try, doggy! Okay!" said Christine.
Nelson wagged his tail and went to the front door, where he lay down.
"Very good!" cried Helen. "I had no idea you taught him all that. He's very smart, isn't he?"
"Todd did most of it. But I taught him to bark when I ask him if he's a good dog. I don't like the begging, frankly, but Todd's been trying really hard to teach him to get his balance."
Anna glanced over at Ike. His head was back on the chair, and he had closed his eyes. He'd been up for nearly an hour, and not a quiet hour.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.